have to start the next subject. It will be just is the spectrality of graphs and Riemann surfaces. I want to start. Let me try once more. Great. Okay, so we start with very, very known phrase, which belongs to the former Soviet Union mathematician Max Katz, who asked everybody, can one hear the shape of a drum? This is a very stupid question, indeed, produced a lot of excellent mathematical papers related with geometry, differential equations, graph theory, and many other subjects of mathematics. What is the main problem we want to solve just looking on this statement? The main problem is the following. When we investigate some objects related with geometry or maybe analysis, very often we have very natural operator, differential operator, or maybe difference operator, which usually is called just Laplacian operator. Then people are interested in the nature of eigenvalues of this operator. Surprisingly, but in any cases, the first non-zero eigenvalue of Laplacian operator very close related with the geometry of object. For example, in the case of hyperbolic manifold, it's more or less responsible for the volume of this guy. And in many other cases, in graph theory, we also can recognize the first number in some very, very natural way. Indeed, in my lecture, I won't deal only with two subjects. The first subject is classical Riemann surface theory. So we are interested in Laplacian operator, which is acting on the given Riemann surface. And other subject, in some sense, closely related from my point of view, this is a graph theory. So we are able to introduce some difference operator, which also called Laplacian. And we are interested in geometrical nature of eigenvalue of Laplacian for graphs. Then the main subject is the following question based exactly in mathematical terms. Suppose that we have two Riemann surfaces, or maybe two graphs, or maybe two other geometrical objects. And for both, we already know the spectrum of Laplacian operator. Suppose for a moment that the spectrum of both Laplacian operator just coincides. Could we say that the geometrical object also coincide in some sense, isometric, isometric, or maybe equivalent in some other sense? This question for the Riemann surface case was investigated by many people. I mentioned just very few papers related to this subject. Wolpers in the 1979 showed that generically Riemann surface is determined by X Laplacian spectrum. Nevertheless, there are a pair of Riemann surfaces of genus greater or equal 4 with the same spectrum, but with a different analytical structure. So they are not is the equivalent as the Riemann surface. Also, different kind of examples were constructed in the papers by Peter Buzer, Robert Brooks, Tse, and other authors. Up to my knowledge, still there are no example when two Riemann surfaces of genus 3 share the same spectrum, but are not isomorphic to each other. The same question is still open for genus 2 Riemann surfaces. In the same time, Robert Brooks, many years ago, proved that if we have two tori And suppose that these two tori share the same spectrum of Laplacian operators, then they are for sure isometric. The same is true also for three-dimensional tori, but this statement fails for the tori of high dimension. My former student Ruslan Isangulov proved a similar result for two Klein bottle. Two Klein bottle, which share the same spectrum, for sure are isometric as a Klein bottle with respected d-analytical structure. Many examples of such kind, also for Riemann surfaces for the graph, are represented in the very nice survey given by Van Dam and Hammers. Indeed, I have used some example coming from their paper as well. Okay, Peter Buzer in the 1992 posed a very interesting problem. Suppose that we have two isospectral Riemann surfaces. Are they isometric as the Riemann surface? Up to our knowledge, the problem is still open, but quite possible can be solved positively. As I know from Peter Buzer, he has a manuscript which contains 1,000 pages, and he said me that probably in this manuscript there is a positive solution of this problem. But I never tried to read so long paper, but pretty sure that sooner or later this problem can be solved positively. The aim of my lecture is to give a positive solution of this problem for the Seta graph, which are natural discrete version of the genus two Riemann surfaces. Because of very close relation between Riemann surface theory and graph theory, we are happy to understand if somebody will use our results from graph theory to prove similar results for Riemann surfaces as well. Recall that two graphs G and G prime are isospectral in Laplacian sense, of course, if they share the same Laplacian operator. So the Laplacian operator just coincide as a polynomial. What is Laplacian operator? It was done in my previous lecture, and maybe I just recall that Laplacian operator for graph is a difference of two matrices. The first one is diagonal matrices formed by degree of vertices of the graph. And the second is just a eccentricity matrix of this graph. The main result of my lecture is the following theorem, independently proved in our paper and in paper of our Chinese colleagues in the same year. I never saw the paper of my colleague before, just during preparation to this lecture, I understand that such paper exists. We have completely different approach to prove the theorem, but in both cases, the technique we have to use is a bit complicated. I try to explain details of our proof. The main result is the following theorem. Suppose the two theta graphs are isospectral, then they are isomorphic. Now, what is the theta graph? Maybe I should say something more about this situation. This is just two typical examples of theta graphs. We have three lines of the length K, L, and M. K stands for the number of edges in the first line, L for the number of edges in the second line, and so on. In principle, it may happen that one of these lines has a length zero. Of course, this is easy to draw on the figure. Well, the main equipment we are going to use in our proof is the following result obtained by Alexander Kelmans in the 1967. which indeed give us a way to recognize the structure of coefficients of the Laplacian polynomial for an arbitrary finite graph. Indeed, if we consider the characteristic polynomial of Laplacian matrix, it has just the following structure. Consider the coefficients number I in this long sequence. Then the theorem by Kelmans told us that these coefficients can be calculated as the number of for the number of spanning trees, which can be calculated on the special graphs labeled by X sub S, where S is just subset of vertices of the graph under consideration. And we suppose that all these vertices are identified together in one unique vertex. So geometrically, it's more or less understandable how to calculate this number if we are able to produce this identification. Later in some examples, I show how we can do this exactly for the set of graph we are going to investigate. So our aim is the following. We want to calculate very few coefficients of this polynomial, because essentially this polynomial is very, very, very long, but set of graph, as we saw before, consists or maybe completely determined by only true parameters, K, L, MM, which are just lengths of lines which formed our theta graph. So we have to find at least three coefficients explicitly as a function of MN. If the graphs are spectral equivalent, this means exactly that the respective polynomial coincide, and also the respective coefficients are the same for both graphs. So we have to solve three equations and find the three unknown variables, namely K, L, M, shown on my picture. Very unfortunately, the first attempt fails because sometimes the system of these three equations may be solved completely. Sometimes it has some extra solution which we have to analyze separately to understand the uniqueness of the graph, which is supposed to be defined, but it's Laplacian spectrum. Certainly, we prefer to deal with so-called elementary symmetric polynomial from our numbers K, L, and M. This is the first symmetric polynomial sigma one. The second one is just product of the double products of these unknowns. And the third elementary symmetric polynomial is just product of these three numbers. It's easy to see that the two graphs, two sets of graphs are isomorphic if the respective symmetric polynomial of order one, two, and three coincide. So we are fighting to find some equations to determine first, second, and the third symmetric polynomial, looking on the structure of our Laplacian polynomial. Okay, let me start. Indeed, it's very easy to recognize the coefficients number n minus one, so it's the second one of this sequence. It just coincides with the double number of edges of our graphs. In the same way, more or less, by making use of the Kelman theorem mentioned above, or just maybe by making use of the classical Kirchhoff theorem, we're able to recognize coefficients number one. It coincides with the number of spanning trees in our graphs times the number of vertices in our graph. So SC1 is exactly the number of rooted spanning trees in our graph. In my lemma two, it's just a very simple expression. So we are lucky to get these two numbers more or less from very beginning. The first, as I already told you, more or less responsible for the number of edges of our graph. And the second, in some sense, corresponding for the number of edges of our graph. And finally, we have the number of trees. Very unfortunately, is this list of symmetric polynomial, we are not able to find the third symmetric polynomial, namely the product of three numbers, K, L, M, N. So these two equations are not sufficient to determine K, L, and M completely. We have to calculate at least one more coefficients of our polynomial. How we can do this? Well, I am trying to fight for the coefficients number two. According to the Kelman theorem, we have to consider two arbitrary vertices of our graph, which formed a set S, identified them together to create a graph labeled X sub S, and calculate the number of spanning trees in such a graph. Then define the sum of the spanning trees passing through all possible two-element subset of our graphs. Later, I show you what kind of two vertex identification can be happens in our particular case. There are very few of them. The first one can be obtained if we are going to identify together two three-valent vertices of our graph, roughly speaking, south and north poles of our graphs. Then we have just the following beautiful flower formed by three loops. Indeed, each loop consists of K, M, and L edges respectively. Also, we are able to identify, for example, south pole together with some point which are chosen of the line consisting of two K edges. As a result, we have the following graph. Two more possibilities also can happen. So the next stage, we should to calculate the number of spanning trees on each of these graphs. This is more or less elementary work. By hand, we can find more or less simple formula for the number of spanning trees in each of the following four graphs. But the next step is we have to summarize all possible situations. And because index I, for example, is going to be an integer number between zero and k. The same is true for the number g, which is supposed to be somewhere between k as well, and so on. So we have some natural restriction which help us to calculate this number more or less explicitly. Believe that in the first case, when we have this beautiful flower, we have to calculate separately the spanning trees on the circle of length K, M, and L respectively. So totally we have K times N times M spanning trees. In the second type graph, we have to be careful because three valent vertex now is identified with one of the two valent vertices. So as a result, we have a kind of five valent vertices of the graph. In any case, sooner or later, we are able to recognize that the symmetric polynomial of order two are responsible for calculation of such a spanning trees. As a result, the total number of spanning trees is given by the following simple expression. As before, sigma two is just a symmetric polynomial of order two from three variables. Because we also have a symmetry, because K, L, M, M, we have to produce kind of symmetrization in our situation. As a result, the total number of trees under consideration is given by the following expression. Certainly, I not try to calculate this number by hand, but it's doable. I just put in the computer and ask it for the final result. Well, final result give us the following expression, where A, B are very special polynomial, which was shown in my slide before. So we are able to find coefficients number two. We are almost lucky to solve our problem completely. So the statement will be almost done, but as I already told before, by some reason, the system of three equations with three unknown has non-unique solution. So to be sure that we are able to find correct solution, we also have to calculate one more coefficient, maybe in the same way. But in this case, we should identify three vertices of our graph together and consider all possible identification of three vertices. And total number of spanning tree on such a configuration is given by the following polynomial expression. What kind of configuration can be obtained if we identify three vertices together? They are the following. You can check. No more possibility can be happens, but of course, again, we are able to choose correctly I, G, S, and other variables, which are also variable in our case, and they are taking some special value from 0 to k, for example, and so on. But it's not a problem because again, we have six very simple configuration. And by hand, we can calculate the number of spanning trees on each of these graphs. Then we have to take a total sum for the number of spanning trees and obtain the coefficients number four, which was shown exactly on the previous lemma. Okay, now we try to prove our theorem. What we have from very beginning? We have should bridge less graphs of genus two, but in our consideration is the same as set a graph. Bridge is a special edge in the graph such that if we delete this bridge, graphs can be decomposed in a few disconnected components. So in our case, there are no bridges, but we have just two graphs of genus two. They are indicated as before by numbers KLM and K'L'M respectively. The respective polynomials are supposed to be the same. So we have equations. Coefficients in the first case coincide with the coefficients in the second case and so on. As a result, we have a number of equations, number of polynomial equations. Of course, the number of vertices coincide. The first coefficients coincide, the second coincides, and so on. Okay, because we know the structure of coefficients number one, number n minus one, number two, and number three, we are able to create a true equations which help us determine the number a prime l prime through the number k l e m. For small graphs, we have some standard problem. So graph with less than six vertices can be considered by hands. We have a full list of such a graph and we able to show very explicitly then they are completely defined by their spectrum. So we suppose that we have at least seven edges in our graphs. As a result, as we saw before, we have an explicit analytical formula of coefficients number two. So we have an equation. C2 prime is the same as C2. There are two possibilities coming. Or coefficients responsible for symmetric polynomial numbers 3 is zero, or maybe is non-zero. In the case when this coefficient is non-zero, we are very lucky, because almost immediately we have that the symmetric polynomial of KLMM do coincide. The same is true for symmetric polynomial of order 2. And finally, because B is different from zero and is the same in both sides of equality, we're able to recognize the symmetric polynomial of order 3 also coincide. This means that unordered triples K, L, and M are the same. They are completely determined by the spectrum of our graph. Very unfortunately, there are graphs, tetragraphs, such that the coefficient beta is equal to zero. Indeed, there are infinite family of such a graph. So we have to consider this situation just separately. Then the situation when we're able to say that coefficients number 3 of our polynomial coincide produces us the following equation. We have to analyze this system of algebraic equation very carefully. And soon or later that we understand that this equation has two solutions. The first solution, symmetric polynomial for prime variables number 3 coincide with symmetric polynomial of the usual parameters. So roughly speaking, K prime times L prime times M prime is the same as KLM. In this case, we can easily conclude that our graphs coincide. But the same stupid equation, unfortunately, has one more non-trivial solution, which is shown on the pie slide. We should analyze this solution very carefully and understand that no geometrical situation corresponds to this solution as well. Because we know the structure of sigma 2 as well, we are able to simplify the above equation in the following way. I should say that all numbers under consideration are positive integer. So this means that the equation like minus 8 plus 3 times sigma 1 for sure is supposed to divide of the number 490. And also very long expression shown in parentheses should be a multiple of the number 729. Analyzing this situation by making use of computer or by hand, we can recognize that indeed the above system has just three possible integer solutions. All of them are shown here. The case when we have six edges are not considered because we already suggested that we have at least seven edges in our graph. The latter two remains for investigation. What happens if we have just sigma 1 equal to 19 or sigma 1 18 to 172? Again, we have to be back to our equations, and soon or later we are able to understand all symmetric polynomials for our variables. We have the following system of equations. Of course, this is just cubic equation, but we should be careful. We are looking only for integer and positive integer or solution of our equations. Well, soon or late, we understand that there are no positive integer solutions which satisfy to this system of equations. In the second case, when sigma 1 is equal to 167, again, by analyzing the respective system of equations, we understand that we have no positive solutions for such kind of equations. We have some of them, but they are not satisfactory for our consideration. So the case sigma 1 is equal to 162 also impossible, and we have already finished the proof of our theorem. Okay. Now, a few comments. First of all, we are looking for the genus 2 graphs which have no bridges. The question, how essential is the demand? Suppose that we have two genus 2 graphs, one is with bridge, another without bridge. No, the theorem is not valid anymore. The following two graphs, both of genus 2, share the same Laplacian polynomial. This Laplacian polynomial is shown on my slide. But for sure, these graphs are not isomorphic because one of them has a vertex of valency 1, and the second one has a vertex of valency 4, which is not the case for the first one. So for sure, we have non-isometric graphs with the same Laplacian spectrum for this case. So the condition that our graphs has no bridge is very essential for consideration of our problem. Again, somebody can ask you, why not to try to investigate a graph of genus 3? Maybe the same method can help us the problem, to solve the problem of isomorphicity of graphs. No, no chance. In the paper of Hammers mentioned in my first slide, there is example of two such graphs. Both are bridgeless graphs of genus 3. For sure, that are not isomorphic because of valency of vertices are different in these cases. There are it's easy to understand that they are not isomorphic. But in the same time, these two graphs, they're the same Laplacian polynomial shown on my slide. So we are not able to use the same method to prove isosymmetricity of graphs with the same Laplacian metric. And moreover, this statement is not true for graph of genus 3. Quite possible, this means that for Riemann surfaces of genus 3, we are also able to construct two Riemann surfaces of genus 3, which are not isomorphic as the Riemann surfaces, but in the same time share the same Laplacian polynomial. Unfortunately, I have no idea how to construct such a Riemann surfaces. Well, what happens in the genus 1 case? Genus 1 case for graphs without bridges is very easy to understand. Bridgeless graph of genus 1 is just a circle. If two circle graphs are isospectral, they for sure have the same number of vertices, so they are isometric. In the same time, there are isospectral genus 1 graph with bridges. For example, we have two following graphs, both of genus 2, with the same Laplacian spectrum, but they are for sure not isometric. So we are not able to prove a similar result even for genus 1 Riemann surfaces if they are with bridges. Now, what we can hear just looking at the spectrum of Laplacian operator of a graph. One can easily hear the genus of graph. Indeed, the genus of graphs can be obtained in the following way. This one minus number of vertices plus number of edges. Every time I am talking about gamological genus of a graph, this is the same as a Betti number of the graph. Because the number of vertices is recognizable by spectrum, the same is true also for the number of edges. We can easily recognize a genus of graphs just looking on the structure of our polynomial. But in the same time, one cannot hear a bridge of a graph. Indeed, before on the physics 4, we considered two isospectral graphs, one with a bridge and another without bridge, with the same Laplacian spectrum. So Laplace is not able to recognize bridge in a graph. Okay. I think this all which is concerning to the first lecture. Certainly, it's quite interesting to continue this subject. Probably, we have to use slightly different instrument to recognize graphs by spectrum. There are many possibilities. Except of Laplacian operator for the graph, there are at least 5-6 more kind of Laplacian operator related with the graphs. This is not the subject of my lecture, but some of my students ask it, why not to use the spectrum of 2 or 3 different kinds of Laplacian operators for the same graph? Maybe they together are able to recognize our graphs by joint spectrum. Probably this is true in some cases. This is just subject for the further investigation. Thank you very much. This is my first lecture. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for this lecture. Are there any questions to Alexander?
Yes, please.
Well, okay, I just have one simple question concerning the structure of these graphs. So, I mean, as a spectral graphs. So yes. You said that doesn't matter, is there a bridge or not? So you cannot recognize, right?
Yes. Because by Laplacian, I cannot do this. Maybe by some another kind of Laplacian operator we are not used in our lecture. It can be done, I don't know. There are many possibilities to do. For example, now is very popular to investigate Laplacian formed by distance Laplacian.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Maybe this is more powerful in this case.
This is but why bridge is so important? I mean.
Once more, what is the question? Even I not understand.
Why bridge is so important in this area?
What means important?
Yeah, I want to say that it is too stupid question. Yeah.
I prefer to avoid it because in my mind, the best graph is without bridges.
Yeah.
And also, there are some reasons because now we're able to create the many results for graphs which are already proved for Riemann surfaces. And the main idea is that if we, from very beginning, suppose that graph has no bridges, everything
works.
If there are some bridges, there are some problems. Probably we can recognize the graph with bridges as a special Riemann surface with no empty border. In this case, maybe we find a parallel.
I see.
Graph as well. We tried, but not so seriously. Some very preliminary that obtained, but probably we have also to investigate the subject more completely.
I see. I don't understand that bridge is not so interesting for you from graph theoretical point of view. So there should be some another reason why you're interested in such graphs. Yeah. Now I do understand. Okay.
No, at least some reason. There are some reasons. Yes. Mm-hmm.